survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you, I need you.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want to take the time to greet our pastor, Andrew S. Henry, and his wife in their absence, Evangelist Wilson, Missionary Robertson, Missionary Wright, Brother Gary, all the saints of the Most High God, my wife, Sister Sam in the back.
Amen.
I greet everyone in the priceless, matchless name of Jesus. While you're standing, turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. Thank you, Jesus. When you have it, say amen. We'll read together verses 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Amen, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, I stand, Lord, before your people, Lord Jesus. Oh God, I avail myself, Lord. Do what you must, Jesus. Speak through me, Lord Jesus. Silence my mind, Lord. Oh God Almighty, I pray, Jesus. Let it flow, Lord Jesus Christ. Speak to your people, Lord, what you would have to say. And let me say no more. In the name of Jesus Christ, have your way. In Jesus' name, glory, hallelujah, hey, glory. I want to speak to us today about the body of Christ. My topic today is, I'm giving my life back to God. The body needs me. Look at your neighbor and say, the body needs me. Look at someone else and say, the body of Christ needs me. Amen. In the beginning, God created. And the fact that the Bible says, in the beginning, you know, I laughed because, you know, beginning speaks of a measurement of time. And we know God is bigger than. But God has created this measure to accomplish his will. Hence, in the beginning, God. So we know God created man in his image after his own likeness. And because he created us, I don't believe that God creates things without a purpose. But God, when he creates with intention. He has a purpose. He has a motive. Something that must be accomplished. Amen. So God said that he's going to create. And he created man. Man now, we see in Genesis that Adam and Eve, they had dominion. God said, have dominion over this creation. Maintain it, till it, take care of it, replenish it, allow it to grow. But somewhere along the line, man was deceived, beguiled. Hence the fall. And because of this fall, we today now are, we're born in sin and shaping in iniquity. All because of that fall. But Thanks be to God that Jesus, in his wisdom, before the measure of time begun, already had a plan of salvation. So before the foundation of the world, the Lamb was slain to set us free. Aren't we glad today that the blood of Jesus Christ gave us that opportunity to live forever, to have eternal life? So we see that man has been distracted for many, many, many generations. We see the children of Israel, you know, they walked around, you know, they started to seek God, and then we saw the backslidings. We saw all the time the cyclical motion. You know, they went back into sin, doubt, didn't believe God. You know, and it's the same today. We see that man has fallen, you know, since the time they were born, you know, and they were raised. We were all raised, you know, with the principles of our parents or forefathers, which were not necessarily, you know, the rules and regulations of God. We were not raised by the word of God in its true form and purity. Amen. Our parents had some good principles. You know, taught us some good things, manners, be polite to your neighbors, etc. But there is more to it than that. Jesus Christ did not come to die just for a set of rules and principles. But he came that we might have life eternal and that we might be with him in life eternal. Amen. So that's where we see now that Jesus, when he came forth, he set a plan in motion that we would have life and have it more abundantly. Jesus now came. He showed us through his disciples, we see in the New Testament, he came on this earth and he walked and he taught the disciples how to live, how to do this Christian walk. Because when he would have been crucified, he would have left the work to them to carry it on. Because he said, greater works shall you do. Amen. Greater works. But we now must be obedient to the principles, the directives that the Lord has set in place. Because, I mean, when I think about the many people that die outside of Christ, it saddens me. Because, I mean, I grew up in a world where I was not seeking the Lord, neither my parents. And I realized that if God didn't send forth a word or make a plan of salvation, I too would have been lost. But I thank God for his intervention. I thank God. Because I tell you, I was in the world and I was doing what I wanted to do. I was a DJ in the clubs. You know, I was jumping up and down giving praise, but not to Jesus. And somewhere along the line, I ended up getting sick. And I realized that all of this sickness and everything was to lead me to Christ.
Thank you.
It was to lead me to Christ. You know, so the Apostle Paul, he picked it up in Romans chapter 12. He said, you know, I beseech you, brethren, therefore, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. And I pulled from the Apostle Paul because the Apostle Paul was one who was living his life doing what he thought was right. But he was persecuting the church. But nevertheless, God still had a plan for the Apostle Paul. So the apostle is speaking by experience and revelation. Because Paul, as he was going along the Damascus road, he had a plan to make havoc, great destruction. But Jesus Christ intervened as he walked along that road. The Lord Jesus Christ met him. And Paul, because Paul did not know who Jesus Christ was, because we use the name God, we walk around and we say God, Jehovah, Jah, but Paul did not know the true and living God. He persecuted the church. So Paul had to say, who are you? Huh? He said, I am Jesus Christ. Let me introduce myself to you. I am Jesus whom you persecute. And we see at this point that Paul, this is where Paul now got the revelation that Jesus Christ is Lord. But still we saw that Paul had to go through a process. He had to go through a process because he lost his sight. So the process now begins. But Paul, he received the revelation that Jesus Christ is Lord. So when Paul wrote now, as a matter of fact, throughout all of the epistles, you know, he wrote by experience and revelation. You know, and he urged, he beseeched the brethren, you know, to get it right. To get their life in order. Because it's not a joke. It's not a joke. Jesus Christ died so that we may have life. He died so that we may live. But there is a way to get to Jesus. There is only one way. And I thank God today that Jesus revealed to me that he is the true and living God. Amen. Amen. So Paul got the revelation that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now look at this. Because the same body that Paul persecuted, Jesus Christ had already carved out a spot in it for Paul. Can you imagine? And I want to point out that some of the very church people, when they heard the name Paul and that there was a place reserved for Paul in the kingdom, they said, no way, cannot be. But thank God that Jesus Christ is no respecter of man or person. But if any man from any nation would worship Jesus, they will be accepted. You know, so it's interesting that the body of Christ, they said, no, could never be this Paul, the one who is a murderer, a persecutor, impossible. But it blew my mind that before the foundation of the world, it was in the plan of God that Paul take his seat in the body. Amen? The next point I want to raise is that Stephen, the man of God, in the body. And Paul, who was going to be introduced into the body, came to kill Stephen, to consent to his murder. What a God. What a God. We can't fathom the moves and the works of God. Because Paul came and consented to the stoning of Stephen. But thank God Stephen was a man who was full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And wisdom and all good fruits. Yes. You know, he didn't fight back. Because that was his purpose. Amen. That was his lot, his portion in the body. He had to be stoned to death. And imagine, he consented unto the death of Stephen. Turn to Acts 7, verse 59.
Hallelujah.
Mighty God.
Hallelujah.
That's right. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, yes, yes.
And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Acts 8, verse 1. And it says, and Saul, who is Paul, was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Verse 3. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hauling men and women, committing them to prison. My God. But yet still, God had a place for him in the body. Saints of God, we have to be careful how we treat people. Because we don't know the purpose and the plan that God has for people. Amen. Because Paul was doing all of these wicked things. And we would say, no way, God would never allow him to be in the church. But he ended up being of the church. My God, we have to be careful and keep our mouths off of people because we don't know. We have no idea, you know, who God is going to use. You don't know, you know, because God put him in the body for a purpose. Though he had to suffer, and he suffered great, great, great persecution. But nevertheless, God chose him to be a leader. He is God's choice. He's God's choice to represent a people. Amen to God. So God now, he created this plan of salvation. And I find it's so mind-blowing, because the way God saves people is not the way that we think. God pulls people from all walks of life. Drunkards, prostitutes, whoremongers, drug dealers. But God is no respecter of man or person. Amen. Give God a praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
So we see now that God, who is no respecter of man or person, he called the apostle for a great work. Likewise, every one of you, there is a purpose on your life. There is a place in the body for every single one of you. The thing is, there is a thing called process, obedience, submission, baptism, the Holy Ghost. It's all a part of the process. And we can't leave out any one part. I don't know where you are individually in your walk. You may have the Holy Ghost. You may be baptized in Jesus' name. You may not be baptized in Jesus' name. But if you're not baptized in Jesus' name, I implore you and beseech you to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Because the minute you get the Holy Ghost, you get the revelation that Jesus Christ is Lord. And no longer can anybody sway you or tell you otherwise. The minute you get the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you realize that Jesus Christ is Lord. I share with you, saints of the Most High. I tell you, when the Lord Jesus Christ fell upon me, like Paul, I saw a bright light shine from heaven. So I can relate. So when people come and say, you don't need to baptize in Jesus' name. You don't need to. God is love. I know God is love. But Christ died. And he said that you must be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. I believed the word and I did it. And God.
And God.
Amen to God. So I don't know where Each and every one of you are in your walk. But I'm telling you, there is a place in the body of Christ for you. But because of the fall of man, man fell out of the will of God. But now you have to get back into the will of God. And it only comes through Jesus Christ. Somebody say, I'm giving my life back to God. Yes, because even some of us who are baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost, after a while, you know, we start to rebuild the things that we once destroyed. You know, and God said, if you do such a thing, you're a transgressor. So we have to search ourselves. I'm not exempt. None of us are. But we have to search our lives. Because we said, we sing, I'm not my own anymore. I belong to Jesus. But now, we seem to be taking up back the life that we threw down. Slowly, the plans that we had in our back pocket. As soon as the sickness is past, as soon as the hurt is past, we pull it out. We pick up where we left off. And God is displeased. But he's a God of mercy and love. If any man would hear his voice. If any man would hear his voice. Because he's slow to wrath. You know, so we got to watch our life. Because sometime in the back of our heart, I tell you, we have plans, we have dreams and aspirations. You know, but we cannot be conformed to this world. We can't follow the pattern of this world, saints of God. Because it will lead to death and destruction. But we have to follow the pattern of God. Because God set a pattern. You understand? And we must be obedient. We cannot take up the things that we once destroyed. We will be called a transgressor. Because when we gave our life to Jesus, we said, I am not my own. In our heart, we made confession that we gave our life to Jesus. When we were baptized, there was a vow that we are going to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen to God. And now, all of a sudden, we see all over the world, you know, Christians are drifting and picking up where they left off. Trying to live the American dream. But the American dream has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. The Lord said, if you would reign with me, you must also suffer with me. You know, so we can't seek after riches. We can't seek the wealth of this world. Because we know the love of money is the root of all evil. Yet we see in the church people are still chasing it. We got to be careful, saints. This is just a reminder to us that wherever we are in the body of Christ, we need to take an inventory of our life and see what's going on. We can't allow ourselves to be beguiled by the devil. You understand? Because the devil presents lots of gifts and opportunities. You understand? But is it in the will of God? You know, we have to find out. We have to find out if it's the will of God before we do things. And even though we make mistakes, sometimes we make decisions that God did not approve, yet God still is a God of mercy. If we realize and acknowledge and humble ourselves and turn, God is a God of mercy. He will see us too. He can take us out of the situation. But we must give our life back to God. Amen. So we see the fall of man is what separated us from God. Because Adam used to hear from God. In the cool of the day in their spot. They were close. They were in a relationship. Intimate. God gave him dominion and said, name it what you want. You understand? We have the same power today, but we're not accessing it. You understand? We're living beneath our privileges. I mean, God, Jesus Christ died and made a way for us to become sons of God. Yet we live beneath our privileges. And all Jesus is saying is just turn and come to me. Bring your burden to me and drop it off. Because he cares. He cares. And there is a great work, saints of God, to do in this body. But each and every one of us have to search ourselves. Because we have to see if our lives truly belong to Jesus. Because he's not going to force himself on us. We must choose Jesus. You understand? Because we say we gave him our lives. You understand? But there's more to it. Because the obedience factor, when the Lord says, do this, we must do it. When he says, go here, you must go. When he says, say this, you must say it. You know, this is a part of not being our own anymore. You know, so we really have to be careful, saints of God, that we are not picking up where we left off. But we have to give our lives back to God. And if you have not yet been baptized in the name of Jesus, it's the only way to reconnect to Jesus. It's the only way to get back to God. Because I tell you, Jesus is a speaking God. It's not just the text alone, but he's a God that speaks. And you'll only know when you go through that right door, the pathway that leads to Jesus. Then you will know that Jesus Christ speaks. You understand? When the man of God or the women of God are preaching or prophesying, you think that it's something they're making up or that they're speaking out your life. But God is a speaking God. He is the Spirit of truth. And the Spirit of truth must speak the truth. He's a discerner. He's a revealer of the intents of your heart. So Jesus knows it already. He knows everything. And all he's saying is, give your life back to me. Just give your life back to me. I don't know where you are, but Jesus is saying, give your life back to me. I want to reconnect you. I want to feed you. In the book of John, you know, Jesus, he gave an example about the vine. You know, and Jesus said, listen, if you are in the vine, you will have everything that you need. Because if just picture a tree and picture the leaves, and if you're a leaf and you're connected to the source, you will have everything that pertains to life. Amen? So Jesus is saying that he is that vine. And thanks be to God, he made a way for us. He made a way for us to be engrafted in. When he engrafts us into, that means we are connected to the source. And if we're connected to the source, whatever the source has flows to us, we have it. Water, food, everything that pertains to life. Everything, every privilege, we have it. Because we're connected to the source. But because of Adam's fall, we were disconnected. But Jesus is saying, I want to reconnect you. I want to feed you again. I want to feed you with the water. I want to feed you with the bread. I want to feed you with the living water. I want to reconnect you. I want to give you something that will make you never thirst no more. But he's saying, you must turn your life over. Let me reconnect you. Let me put you back in so you can be in fellowship. He wants to plug you in and give you power. The other problem is, some of us now, we're connected. And if you look at this tree, the tree is connected to the source. But still, have you ever seen a leaf ask the source for a car?
ahead.
A house.
Go ahead.
Anything outside of. And you know, I read the Bible and it's so peculiar. Because it says if you abide in me. You know, like, we have to look at these examples, saints. Because if you're in the vine. And you're supposed to bring forth fruit. We would spend all of our time asking, because he said, if you love me, ask me what you will, and I will do it.
That's right. That's right.
But if my intention is to bring forth fruit, I'm going to ask for water. I'm going to ask for soil. I'm going to ask for sun. I'm not going to ask for stones. I'm not going to ask for sand. But I'm going to ask for things that pertain to life. It's very peculiar because Jesus said, ask what you will.
That's right, you have to ask.
You know, and even though we're sons of God,
right,
and we can ask whatever,
right,
but if we love Jesus,
right,
we'll ask for the things that will help us to bring forth fruit.
Yeah. Amen.
Because we must be fruitful.
Amen.
We have to bring forth fruit in this Christian walk.
That's right.
This Christian walk is not about house and car and land. Those things are not blessings. They're provisions. God will give you a car. That's no problem. Because you need it to get downtown in 5 minutes to witness. He'll give you a car. He'll give you a house. But you have to put up the saints. Give you these things, but it's just for provision.
Amen.
But when you go to God and ask God for things, ask him for things that will help to bring forth fruit. Because we have to bring forth fruit. Because what did Jesus say? If you don't bring forth fruit, he's gonna cut you out and cast you into the fire. You must be a profitable servant, because God has placed in every one of you gifts. You may not even know who you are, but the gifts are in you. But it's only when you come to Jesus, because you could be gifted till you're dripping. But if you're not obedient to Jesus, your gifts won't manifest. You'll be operating out of line of Jesus. You may speak things, but it's not what Jesus is saying. You must be in line with Jesus Christ. Amen. Because he is the source. He is the source. And he said that we must abide in him. So the church of God, the Apostle Paul mentioned that he beseeches us. You know, we must present our bodies a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable. The whole duty is to bring forth fruit. This body, our body especially, in wisdom and life. Full of giftings. Full of giftings. But we have to walk in obedience. Because there's a few in here that still have not given their life to Jesus. You know, and I have to speak.
Go ahead, brother.
Because, you know, we could be going along all together. All along. Having a good time. But when the trumpet sounds. You know, I don't want to even see that. I tell you. Because we're in the building, but we must get into the vine. We have to get into and tap into the source. That's the only way. We are going to make it and get up out of here.
That's right.
Because it's the Spirit of God.
That's right.
That will, if you will hear it. You will know when it blows. Boom! It's the only way to get up. Otherwise, you will sleep. Amen to God. So, we have to make sure that we are in the vine. We have to make sure that we are grounded. We have to make sure that Jesus Christ is our source. Because he didn't just die. It would make no sense for him to just come and die and you could go to heaven any way you want. It makes no sense. He would just send a memo. But he came and died to take the sins and transgressions of all of us. So the minute I get in Christ, my life is hid. My sins are covered. I am dead. I'm no more. I am in Christ, a new creature. You know, so we have to get into Jesus Christ if we are going to function in the body. Because you see the picture, all of those little pieces represent each and every one of us. Some of us are already in the body, and some of us are still on our way coming. But there is a place for you. There is a place for you. But you have to surrender to Jesus so that he can put you in the body, connect you, and feed you with the living water so that you can go forth and bring forth fruit. Amen. Tell somebody, I'm giving my life back to God. Mean it. Mean it. Tell someone else, I'm giving my life back to God. Because we've all slipped at some point. We've all fallen from our steadfast at some point. But now that we recognize, now that we know, we have to get up. You know, because, and I tell you something about being in Christ. Because there's no condemnation. It doesn't matter what you've done.
Go ahead.
What you've done. As long as you make confession.
That's right.
Because it's not a license to sin. But when you are under the blood, there is no condemnation. If you fall, you can get up again. You acknowledge, Jesus, I'm sorry. I'm trying to get to you and I fell in a pit. But get up and get out. Because there's work to do. There's work to do in this kingdom. But we have to take our rightful place in the body. Thank you, Jesus. So the spot in the body that's reserved for you, you can't fit in there just like that. Because you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. So the spot is, you won't fit unless you go to Jesus, because Jesus has to put you on the potter's wheel. He has to put you on the potter's wheel. Because this little spot here is reserved. But you can't fit in there with all the excess. Jesus has to mold you. He has to shape you. He has to fashion you. He has to cut you. He has to shave. He has to carve you. He has to make you again another vessel. So when you go into your position, you fit.
Go ahead.
Your spot is uniquely yours. It's reserved for you. Nobody can sit in your spot. But you must submit to God.
Amen.
And let him mold you.
Right.
Let him carve you.
That's
let him shape you. And
right.
Put you in your spot.
Amen.
It's a process.
Amen.
It's a process. But you have to go through the process. You have to submit to authority. Those that have the rule over you. You can't go ahead of the plan. Because Jesus prepared a spot for you. But you have to go through the process.
Yes, sir.
You have to search.
Yay.
You have to check.
Hallelujah.
You have to check.
Hallelujah.
You have to shame.
Hallelujah.
You have to say, Jesus, I still don't fit.
Right.
Jesus has to mold you again.
Right.
He has to mold you again.
Right.
And put you in your spot.
Amen.
Only when you're in your spot, then you will function. You will function
you.
With the authority and the unction with whatever God has placed in you.
Amen.
Because you have gifts.
Right.
But they can't operate.
Right.
Because you have to get inside the will of God.
Right.
God has a place for each and every one of you.
Amen.
But until you submit, until you humble yourself
right.
at the feet of the Almighty
right.
God,
right.
He will leave us right there
right.
until we say, yes, Lord,
right.
not my will,
right.
but thy will be done. So the Apostle Paul, he was a work in progress. He was a work in progress. Because he had to be fashioned. He had to go through mentorship. He had to be trained. You know, when Paul said things like, you know, I count everything that I knew dung for the excellency. You know, he's not just saying these things, but it's experience. He went through a process. Can you imagine being blinded? Can you imagine being blinded, going through all of this? But thanks be to God that, you know, he will never leave us or forsake us.
Amen.
You know, but the plan that he has, he says, I have plans to prosper you. And to give you an expected end. You know, but we just have to fall into line, into the will of God. We just have to fall in line with Jesus and let him do the molding. Let him do the shaping. Because I can't do it for myself. I can't do it for you. You understand? But Jesus knows exactly the dimensions. He knows when he looks and the spot that's for you, Jesus knows exactly how to carve it out so that you're going to fit. You know, so when Paul got to the end of his journey, he was able to say, you know, I have kept the faith. I ran the race. I fought a good fight. I've finished my course. He can say things like, no, I'm ready to be offered. But what did Paul have to go through? Persecution, mentorship, shipwreck, hated, despised. He had to go through all of these things. All of these things to get to the end where he could say, okay, now I'm finished. Now I'm finished. I'm ready to be offered. Because you can't be offered back to God if you're not perfected. Anything that ascends to God must be a sweet-smelling savor. It must be just right. You understand? So if you have not completed your mandate, don't even look to get out of here. Because it will go up to God and God will say, no, but fire will burn it. You know, so we have to make sure that we run our course.
Yes.
That we do whatever God has mandated us to do. You understand? Because only when Paul knew, he had an assurance that he finished. He finished.
Yes, he had an assurance.
And he said, yes, now I'm ready to be offered. My God. My God. He said, there's a crown laid up for me. With assurance, he said it. And he also said, but not only for me, but to all those. All those. That's us. There's a crown laid up for us too. But we have to do the will of God. We have to fall in line. Make him chisel us. Put us in the body. Send us out to work. And when you finish your course, you too can say, I finished.
Yes.
Henceforth, there is a crown laid up for me too.
Yeah, Lord, help. Holy.
But we have to submit to the process.
Yes.
It's hard at times. I tell you, you know, the trials in my life, they increase. They've been increasing. You know, but I realize it's a part of it. It's a part of the process. Because trials and tribulations, hardships, it helps to make the anointing flow. It squeezes it. It squeezes like the olive. Squeeze it to let the oil come out. You know, if we're not under pressure, something is wrong. That means we haven't started yet. You know, so we just have to submit to the process of God so that he can put us in the body, because the body needs me. The body needs you.
Amen.
There's something that you have that I need.
Amen.
You know, I need you and you need me.
Amen.
But whatever is in you won't be of excellent and perfect we can't use it unless you submit.
Yes, sir, to the will of
God. Must submit to the will of God. Amen. So that God can raise you up and you can operate in your gifts.
Right.
You know, because we need each other.
Amen.
You know, we all have giftings.
That's right.
We all have giftings.
That's right.
I tell you. You know, when people are sick in the church, you know, there's people in this church with a gift of healing.
That's right.
You know, but they're waiting on another gift to push them forward so that they can heal. You know, there's people in here with a praise that when they praise, they chase the devil out of here. There's people that can pray that when they pray, chains are broken. There are people that can sing.
Right.
And when they sing, people rejoice.
Hallelujah.
You understand? When pastor comes to preach, you know, if all the giftings are in operation,
That's right.
The encourager encourages.
That's right.
The singer sings.
That's right.
The praiser praises.
Yes.
The preacher can preach.
Amen.
The glory will come down.
The glory will sit on us. Yes.
But the body has to function.
Amen.
The body has to function. But I need all of the giftings to operate. It must be in operation so that the flow, the real flow of the body can happen. Because the body is moving. But if some of the parts are not moving, it puts stress on the other parts. It puts stress on the heart.
My God, go ahead.
The other parts suffer. You know, because when one part is not working, the other part has to work extra hard.
Huh?
If you have two kidneys and the doctor has to take one out, the other one works extra hard. And it's not to say you can't function, but all the pressure is on one kidney. And it's very difficult. If you have a stroke, it puts pressure on the body and has the potential of crippling that body. Why? Because there was something that went wrong. Some system failed. It's like us, we have a responsibility. Whatever your giftings and callings are, if you don't press, if you don't push, if you don't submit, and get into your role in the body.
That's right.
Someone else will suffer. Someone may perish.
Lord,
someone may die.
Lord,
because the body will struggle.
Right.
You know, we have to really, really be careful. Really be careful. You know, because in the Bible, it speaks about the man that hid his talents. You know, he buried it.
Yes.
And God can't deal with that. Because the body will suffer.
That's right.
So we have to be careful, very careful. Because God will do a transplant. You know, because his body must accomplish the will.
That's right.
So if God has called you to be something, you need to submit. You know, we all need to submit and stop playing around with the will of God. Because God can do a transplant.
Huh?
The surgeons, they learn from Jesus.
Amen.
The doctors learn from Jesus. When something is wrong, Jesus can either fix it, but if it won't be repaired, he will take it out. And he'll put another one in so that the body can function. The question today is, do you want to be a part of the body?
Jesus.
Do I want to be a part of the body? We must. If we want to be a part of the body, we must submit.
Hallelujah.
We must be obedient. We must exercise selflessness.
Yes. My
even to death, so that the will of God may be accomplished. It's only then we will see the great and greater works that Jesus wants to accomplish. And especially in this house, we're in the midst of transition. And when we leave, this building, we're going to have to walk as a body. Because we're going to go into all the world and preach this gospel. But I want to see every one of you in the body. I want you to see me in the body. I don't want any one of us to be cut out and cast into the garbage. But I want us all to earnestly and sincerely seek his face.
Hallelujah.
Find out how we can get in the will of God.
Right.
Or get back into the will of God.
Yes.
Or stay in the will of God.
Right.
Because some of us, we have power. And we have our giftings. But we've strayed a bit. Some of us are halting between two opinions. Should I be baptized? Is it necessary? God is one. God is love. We know that. But you must be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, which is the Spirit of God himself moving on the inside of you, leading you. It's the only way. Don't be fooled by churches that have no denomination. Don't be fooled by, you know, the Christianity you see out there. I didn't know anything about church. I wasn't going to church. But Jesus saw fit to reveal himself to me so that I might tell somebody that of a truth, this is the way.
That's right.
You can't just jump up and down in church. It's not just that. There is a living God that wants to dwell on the inside of you, that wants to control and send you and lead you and speak through you.
That's right.
You know, but we have to submit and do it the right way. And there is only one way, and that's through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Stand with me.
God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
At this time, if there's anyone that would like to recommit themselves to the Lord, if there's anyone that would like to surrender their life to the Lord, if there's anyone that needs a touch, come to the altar. The altar is open. And saints of God, this altar is for us. It's for the body. It's for us. Come. Raise your hands to heaven, everyone. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you. Oh God, for a sweet day of fellowship, Lord. Oh God, we thank you, Jesus. Oh God, for your mercies and your loving kindness. Oh God, we thank you, Lord, that because of your love, we are not consumed. We thank you that you're not a God that condemns, Lord Jesus. Oh God, but you speak to us because you love us, Lord Jesus, and you desire us to make it, Lord. Father, I pray that you have your way today, Lord, in our lives. Oh God, cover us, protect us, lead us, guide us, Lord. Help us all to search our lives over, Lord Jesus. Oh God, for we are not yet perfected, Lord. Oh God, but as we run this Christian race, I pray, Jesus, give us the wisdom that we need, Lord. Oh God, to apply your word, Jesus, that we may escape from the wiles of the devil. Oh God Almighty, we thank you today, Jesus. Oh God, cover us as we go into fellowship, Lord. And as we leave this place, Jesus, cover us, I pray. Have thine own way, I pray. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need.